Great. Thanks, Steve. Can everybody hear me? Is my mic on?
Yeah.
Okay, we're good. All right, well, my name is Dan Casale. I'm really excited to be here at ENR FutureTech and talk about what DPR and Trimble are doing. I only have 15 minutes, so let me turn my remote on here. We're going to go over a quick history of how the project came to be, what the inspiration was, where it stands right now, and where we think it's going next. So as Steve mentioned, Project Lion is a joint venture of sorts between DPR and Trimble. And as this slide shows, it's a robot. So these images are what you might think of when you think robot. Some of it's sci-fi, some of it's automotive industry, military. They're all robots, and I could even have some zeros and ones up there because software can be robots as well, performing tasks that can be automated. So I like to start with a quick joke, and what do you get when you cross a farmer and a robot? A transformer. So actually this is a farming robot, and all of these are robots that I found on the internet. Here are some more robots that are actually out in various industries right now, whether it's a golf course that's using an automated robot to mow greens, whether it's a robo-screeder to get super flat floors, and even some automated welding robots. They're all out there in the industry. So how did the project come to be? I started working with DPR in San Francisco and working on the UCSF Mission Bay Hospital. It's a 1 million square foot hospital and 180 beds, so there's quite a bit of space there. And DPR was self-performing the drywall on this project. As we were self-performing the drywall, we had a great opportunity to see how we can leverage BIM to make ourselves more efficient. On this project, it was a pilot project, although a large pilot project, to model all of the studs. And modeling the studs was important because we wanted to save space for framing. OSHPOD has some really stringent engineering requirements, and if there's not space for framing, then you can get inefficient having to do built-up headers and other things very quickly. However, a secondary goal was we wanted to prefabricate as many of these rooms and as many of these walls as possible. So now that we have all of our studs modeled, we can try to standardize as many wall panels as possible. And that's what we did. We took the three most common rooms, patient rooms, outpatient rooms, other rooms, and we modeled them and tried to panelize them. We did virtual mock-ups and did about probably 15 different panel configurations for each room. And when we thought we had it figured out, we did a live mock-up with those panels. So we did three rooms that we did panelized, and we did those same three rooms in a traditional build method. During that time, we had a master's student from Berkeley named Yanni doing her thesis on our prefabrication strategy, and that was great to have a third-party observer who didn't have a horse in the race. And interestingly, what Yanni observed is that it was going to take us twice as long with our panelized process on this project as it would to stick build it. And that was a number of things. One, all of the walls were full height, so there's custom stuff that still needs to be done up above. Two, it was the first time we've done it, so it's a new process. Not everybody's comfortable with it. Three, we didn't have specialized tools to go and lift up all these heavy panels to get them in place. So there were a number of reasons that it might have taken a little bit longer. However, I was also observing the project as a stakeholder and being involved in the BIM effort on it. And what I noticed was that layout took a long time. And layout took a long time whether we were doing it prefabricated or whether we were doing it with a stick build. And not only did it take a long time, it was prone to mistakes. We had to lay it out more than once in both settings. The panels, they had studs that went all the way up. They had to be in very specific spots. And we had some difficulty getting it there. So at that time, I had an idea, and I went and talked to our regional drywall project manager about how long it takes us to do layout. What is that line item number? You know, it's got to be an item in the schedule. And he gave me a rule of thumb that it's 120 to 150 linear feet per hour, per man hour. From here on, I'm going to use 150 linear feet per man hour because that is the aggressive number. So if we can beat that, we're doing well. And also from looking at a couple of healthcare projects, there is about 0.15 linear foot of drywall for every square foot on a project. So if you scale that up, that's 10,000 square foot, 1,500 linear feet, 10 man hours to lay out 10,000 square feet. Now, that might not sound too slow, 150 linear feet per hour, but if you think at the pace I'm walking across the stage right now, I'm probably going close to 15,000 linear feet per hour. You know, 2.5 miles an hour, 2.8 miles an hour, that really adds up when you're going 150 to 15,000. There's, you know, orders of magnitude of opportunity there to speed up. Now, I thought it's probably a little bit too aggressive to go and think we're going to get 15,000 linear feet per hour. But what if we could get just 1,000 linear feet per hour? In that same 10 man hours, we could do almost 70,000 square feet. Now, there might never be 70,000 square foot of floor space ready for you to lay out drywall at once. But that 0.15 linear feet of wall is just walls. Mechanical systems need to be laid out, electrical, plumbing, furniture systems, light switches, all of these things need to be laid out. If we had something that was efficient enough and fast enough, you could actually just draw the whole floor plan on the ground, and it's like a coloring book, just put it in between the lines. Now, what makes me think that you can speed it up and do it close to a walking pace is robotic total stations, and I've seen them. I'm sure all of you have used them, or maybe not used them, but know about them. Robotic total station is a robot. It's commercially available. It's in the construction industry, and it will take XYZ coordinates out of any authoring platform, whether that is Revit, Tekla, Graphisoft, even down to your lowest common denominators of DWGs, DXFs. You can get an XYZ coordinate in there. It's correlated to a real point in space. As you can see, this is a robotic total station setup. There's the robotic total station tracking the prism, and you have an LCD screen on there that is guiding you to the point. And so it will tell me if I'm trying to get to the corner of the stage that I need to walk forward 10 feet to the left 2 inches. And depending on the prism, it's going to give you an update of what your direction should be 20 times per second. So that's part one of why I thought we could probably do this. Part two is the Roomba. The Roomba is another commercially available robot. You can go on Amazon right now and order one for $250, and it will be at your house tomorrow, vacuuming your home from infinity and beyond forever. And it will even charge itself. So it sounds simple, right? I'm just going to take this Roomba, I'm going to strap some pens on the back of it, put a prism on it, and send it free to do layout. It'll be done in a month. Well, it's taken a bit longer than that. So this is a little bit of the evolution of the project. The first top left corner is the proof of concept. Myself and Jeremy Bartle, another DPR project engineer, built in my apartment. And we actually taped a Sharpie to that and programmed it to drive a square and figured, hey, if we can order a kit on the internet and do this for $125, there's probably something to it. After that, we got some real robot builders involved and some real programmers, and you can see it's gone through a couple of iterations there. So what are we doing? We're taking that lowest common denominator, that DXF, that DWG, we're extracting points from it, running through a software, giving a path, feeding that path to the robot, and then the total station verifies that the robot is where it's supposed to be. So what it is it's not a replacement for skilled layout personnel. It is an augmentation. You still need somebody who knows the layout mechanics. You still need somebody to check for errors. But what we're doing is we're giving that person who has the skills to do 150 linear feet per hour and giving him the tools to do it at 1,000 linear feet per hour or better. So these are the latest and greatest robots. There are two of them now. The one on the right has some PVC tubes, so you can use any medium to mark, whether it's a Sharpie, dry erase marker, laser pointer, etc. The one on the left is the latest one, just got finished with the build, I think last week, and it actually has inkjet printers on board. So it has 4 inkjet printers. It can print multiple colors, it can print patterns, and it has a very fine line that it displays. So what have we done with the robot so far? We've tested it in various warehouses. We've tested it on substrates, regular sealed concrete, on projects that had the carpet ripped up, so there's carpet glue on the ground, and we've tested on linoleum, epoxy, but all of these have just been tests. None of this is production yet. Hopefully we'll have a production opportunity coming up over the next month or two, now that we finally have a suitable marking mechanism. The inkjet printers were kind of the holy grail of us trying to figure that out. And what we found, and I'll start queuing up this video real quick, is that we are getting about 2.5 linear feet per second in a straight line, and we are getting about 30 seconds to do each turn. So what's that mean? If we have a 15 linear foot average for our wall length, that would mean that we get about 1,500 linear feet per hour. Now, I think 15 feet for an average wall length is a little bit too long, so I'm going to go ahead and keep my target of 1,000 linear feet per hour. That would take the average wall length down to somewhere around 10 feet, which I think is a good round number. And then, you know, the turns, depending on how many turns you have, that's going to impact what your production rate is. Also, it can do arcs, which I'll show in another video here shortly, but the arc speed is also slower. So what's next? We are still working on the software. We're working on the algorithms and the Kalman filters, which will help smooth out the lines. We're adding data collectors to it, so not only is it going around and marking the floor, but actually taking measurements about its environment. And we're working on the general user interface so that you don't have to know the whole background of it to use it. User-friendly is a big part of technology, and putting the tools in the hands so somebody can actually do it. So while these videos are playing, if I did leave some time for questions, but I guess we'll do those at the end.
How long is your next video?
The next video is a couple minutes long, but... Okay, yeah, that's fine.
Take a minute here while technology hooks up our third presenter's computer, and we can take a couple of questions if anybody has them. Yes, sir. Can you hang on just a second and identify yourself first?
Vince with Swinnerton Builders. You might have mentioned it. How does the robot communicate? Is it self-contained with the computer on board, or does it communicate with the robot? Robotic total station.
So yes and yes. It communicates with the robotic total station via an onboard computer. So there's a computer on board, and when you're setting it up, you're actually remoting into the onboard computer. The onboard computer, it functions a lot like a grader doing, you know, a grader that's hooked up to a total station that's constantly adjusting the blade, runs on the same concept.